Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Tuesday special meeting of council for Tuesday, August 11th, 2020. I'll turn it over to Ms. Mrazek for the roll call.
Councilor Brusseau?
Here.
Councilor Robertson?
Here.
Councilor Mendocino?
Here.
Councilor Maine?
Present.
Councilor Anthony?
He's muted.
Here.
Councilor Tignanelli?
Here.
Councilor Bain?
Here.
Councilor King?
Present.
Councilor Bill Vrabosch?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Tanya Vrabosch?
Here.
Mayor Mc, sorry, all present with the exception of Mayor McDonald.
Okay, at this point, I'll ask if there's any conflicts of interest. Seeing none, I'll pass it over to Ms. Keefe.
Moved by Councilor Bill Vrabosch, seconded by Councilor King, that the following bylaw be read a first and second time. Bylaw number 2020-64 to amend City of North Bay's procedural bylaw number 2019-80.
And I apologize. I don't know if I was muted at that point, but did you guys hear me when I asked if there was any conflicts? You did hear me? Okay, sorry. Okay, and then I'll turn over to, nope, that is.
Oh, all in favor?
It's a little bit odd not being at home. So at this point, is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor? If you can just hold your hand up for a moment. Okay. Okay, those opposed? Motion's carried.
Moved by Councilor Bill Vrabosch, seconded by Councilor King, that the following bylaw be read a third time and passed. Bylaw number 2020-64.
All those, any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Motion's carried.
Moved by Councilor Bill Vrabosch, seconded by Councilor King, that the following bylaw be read a first and second time. Bylaw number 2020-65 to confirm proceedings of the special meeting of council held on August 11th, 2020.
Any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councilor Bill Vrabosch, seconded by Councilor King, that the following bylaw be read a third time and passed. Bylaw number 2020-65.
Any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councilor Mendocino, seconded by Councilor Tignanelli, that this special meeting of council do now adjourn at 6:20 p.m.
Okay, and at this point, we're going to end and adjourn the meeting until 6:30 p.m. At that time, we will start a regular meeting of council. Hey everyone, this is the regular meeting for council for Tuesday, August 11th, 2020. And I'll pass it over to Ms. Mrazek for the roll call.
Councilor Brusseau?
Here.
Councilor Robertson?
Here.
Councilor Mendocino?
Here.
Councilor Maine?
Present.
Councilor Anthony?
Here.
Councilor Tignanelli?
Present.
Councilor Bain?
Here.
Councilor King?
Present.
Councilor Bill Vrabosch?
Present here.
Deputy Mayor Tanya Vrabosch?
Here.
All present with the exception of Mayor McDonald.
Okay, at this time, I'll ask if there's any conflict of interest. Seeing none, I'll turn it over to Ms. Keech for to start the meeting.
Moved by Councilor Tignanelli, seconded by Councilor Mendocino, that the minutes of the public meeting held on Tuesday, July 21st, 2020 be adopted as presented.
Any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councilor Bill Vrabosch, seconded by Councilor King, that council approve the award of a contract to eScribe Software Limited in the amount of $111,541.36 plus HST for the implementation of a new electronic agenda management solution and ongoing licensing, support, and upgrades for 5 years, with an option in favor to the city to extend the contract on the same terms and conditions for three additional terms of up to 1 year each.
Okay, at this point, I'll ask if there's any discussion. Councilor Vrabosch as the mover.
Yes, I just want to mention this contract will allow continuation of electronic agendas to members of council. Without the award of this contract, as of December 31st, 2020, the city would need to revert back to paper agendas I don't think a lot of people would be happy with that one. So the $111,541 is for 5 years, and it's eScribe software. And it's like I say, it's over a 5 year period. The first year amount is $29,075, includes the cost of implementation, training, and initial licensing. Currently, there's $30,000 in the capital project budget, so we're okay in that money. City currently pays an annual licensing fee for the existing software. The $21,000 per year for the remaining 4 years new contract will result in cost savings, which would be good news for a lot of people who are looking for efficiencies.
Thank you. I have Councillor Tiganelli and then Councillor King.
Yeah, just to follow up on Councillor Bill Raybosch's comments, it's great that the public needs to realize that we're actually not spending any more money. We're switching to a Canadian provider who is currently providing the same software for about 200 plus municipalities across Ontario. So seeing that we're switching to an Ontario-based company, it's catered more for Ontario municipalities, and I think that this is a decision moving forward, and it's also cloud-based.
Councillor King.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I concur actually with the mover of the motion. I think it's important again to recognize that the original amount of $29,000 was the first year of that contractual obligation. I guess to recognize also that those dollars were held in a reserve fund for the last 5 years for this particular use, certainly does provide the necessary, movement of this process from a council standpoint. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Robertson.
Thanks, Deputy Mayor Raybosch. So, I try to scrutinize all these awards for contracts that we get. I try to be critical of them and try to make sure they reach a certain threshold, even though this one doesn't seem like a lot of money because it's $100,000 over 5 years. Originally, I had some concerns about this because some of the other ABCs that deal with confidential documents are able to do so, are able to share those documents with members and with members of the public and with media via websites and via email. So, I thought that might be a good way for us to save a couple bucks. But having spoken to staff about it, it became clear that email was not the alternative, that for reasons of confidentiality and other things, that the alternative would be paper copies. So there's going to be a cost associated with that. I think that's probably a step backwards when it comes to efficiency and when it comes to protecting confidential documents. So so I'm going to be supporting this motion, and that's all. Thank you, Deputy Mayor.
Any further discussion? Councillor Raybosch?
Just to wind up, I think this was mentioned by Mr. DeCare when he did his audit report. And this is one of the in-house efficiency programs that he suggested that we do. And it will be a cost savings. And I think it's a great thing because the paperwork will be cut down. So I think Councillor Robertson will be happy with that. But thank you very much.
Okay. All those in favor? Those opposed? Motion carried.
Moved by Councillor Main, seconded by Councillor Anthony, that Council approve the award of a contract to FST Canada Inc. operating as Joe Johnson Equipment in the amount of $553,992.94 plus HST for the provision of a new combination hydro excavation and sewer cleaner truck.
Councillor Main.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Raybosch. This truck was actually approaching end of life, but unfortunately there was an engine fire earlier in the summer, so we've advanced its replacement to right now. It's a vehicle that's highly used in both excavation and sewer cleaning, so it needs to be replaced. The quote of $553,992 from FST was considered fair and reasonable.
I'm going to do all in favor. If you can just hold your hands up for just a moment. Okay, thank you. Those opposed? Motion's carried.
Moved by Councillor Main, seconded by Councillor Anthony, that Council approve an award of a contract to Direct Construction Inc. in the amount of $119,175.11 plus HST for the construction of a female change room at the wastewater treatment plant.
Any discussion? Councillor King?
I guess this is probably directed more to the chair. It appears now that as we watch the changes in public entities, it's now become obvious that gender-neutral washrooms are part and parcel of the building requirements. And I didn't want to put the chair on the spot over this issue, but I think probably after the meeting or some discussion might be advisable to take place with the building department to see if in fact that's a requirement. I know we've run into that with respect to the shelter, and of course that does create some interesting process with respect to washrooms. So just more a comment, Madam Chair, to the Chair of Public Works.
And I'll let him respond to that at the end if he wants. And I have Councillor Brusso.
Oh, thank you, Deputy Mayor. I'm glad to see this discrepancy rectified. Women have been working at the facility for a few years now. To have same access to service for all staff members is part of the obligations of an equal opportunity employer. I fully support this motion.
Any further discussion? All right, seeing none. All in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Rabosch, seconded by Councillor King, that Council approve Appendix A, allocation of city share of municipal accommodation tax as attached to report to Council Corp 2020-70 from Margaret Kopenko, dated July 15th, 2020.
Any discussion? Councillor Rabosch?
This policy identifies how the city will spend its share of the MAT, which is the municipal accommodation tax, which is implemented in 2018. Primary focus of the policy is investing in tourism-related infrastructure such as trails, community centers, waterfront development, etc. The policy also incorporates an opportunity for private tourism-related organizations to approach Tourism North Bay with projects and programs that really enhance tourism. This grant application process will be managed by Tourism North Bay, and Council will set aside the funds through the annual budget process. Through consultations in establishing the policy, Tourism North Bay is supportive of this approach.
Any further discussion? Councillor Main?
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Rabosch. And I guess either to you or Councillor Rabosch, look, I'm pleased to support this. Assuming that the Tourism North Bay budget is public, will we be receiving a copy of their budget? Basically, how are they spending the money on an annual basis?
I just have to check. I'm not used to being in this. Apparently, I'm not allowed to answer that question, so I will refer that to Councillor Rabosch.
Well, I think what you're looking at here is this is an interim situation we're into right now, and this is a situation. It's a half-year project thing. It's always being monitored. It looks like, and I checked into some of the monitoring policies, so I would imagine that any request for a budget update from these people would be easily available to you, Councillor Main. So I don't see a problem with it. I think they've been very responsible up to this point, and I think that this will just continue the work for them.
Okay, Councillor King?
Yes, and I do, share Councillor Main's concern with respect to the expenditures. That 60% of that $1 million expenditure, obviously. It's my understanding that Mr. Greeny is due to come back to council with a presentation to indicate just the expenditures and how the money was spent. I think we all need to understand how that's been done.
Councillor Robertson?
Thanks, Deputy Mayor. I did want to make a couple of comments on here. My primary concern is the 40% that comes to our city, it comes to us, and the way we spend that money. I know that the policy here that's outlined, which was a very simple, straightforward policy, which I appreciated, outlined sort of criteria that we're going to be using when we release money from this reserve account during budget time, and should we decide to make council resolutions in terms of how to spend this money. But I just wanted to quickly talk about the criteria. So it talks about three things. Oh, let me pull this up. Fund tourism-related infrastructure projects, finance new projects or improve venue capacity and sustainability in order to strengthen the city's ability to attract major tourism-related events. So to me, those first two, A and B, refer to public city-owned infrastructure. And then the final one is C, it's leverage private sector and government capital investments to support initiatives that encourage tourism infrastructure development. So that third criteria, C, is geared towards partnering with Tourism North Bay, as well as third-party entities for events and other things that might develop our tourism infrastructure. And that's great, and I think there should be a room for that, and I'm going to be supporting this policy, and I think there should be room for that event sponsorship type of element in terms of how we use this money. But when we get to budget time, when we talk about how to allocate this money, I think the emphasis, the great emphasis, needs to be on public infrastructure and on city-owned infrastructure, because we all, as we all know, we're always trying to find money to maintain and build and make our capital investments. And so that's how I'd like to see the bulk of this money used. And that's my comments. Thanks, Deputy Mayor. But I will be supporting the policy.
Any further comments? Councilor Mendocino?
Thanks, Chair. So definitely going to be supporting this. I mean, the good news is that in 2019, the municipal accommodation tax brought in approximately $900,000. So that's very, very good news. Tonight, we're looking at a policy to implement process to allocate the city portion, which is part of process that we need to do. But I'm certainly looking forward to discussing this further during the 2021 budget process. I'm hearing what's been said by other councillors. The other entity that we can't forget about is the third party, non-for-profit private entities that work on a volunteer basis and drive tourism to the region. So, like I said, this is a work in progress, and I'm looking forward to the discussion during the budget process in 2021. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Not, we'll let Councilor Raybosch wrap it up.
I just want to go back to Councilor May's request to see budget. I know this is basically all budgets, but I think we can get this report for you very soon, and I think you have a right to it. But I think this is a good move, the MAT tax, and I know Councilor Mendocino works heavy duty in this thing. So I think this is great for the city. It shows good investment for us. And I really like the process we're using right now. Thank you.
Okay. All in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Raybosch, seconded by Councillor King, that Council receive and file the City of North Bay's Water and Wastewater Year-End Financial Projection for the period ending June 30th, 2020, as set out in Report to Council Corp 2020-64, dated July the 20th, 2020, from Laura Wassenaar.
Okay, any discussion, Councillor Raybosch?
Yeah, probably one of the more talked about items is water and sewer. The water and sewer operations has not been affected, impacted by COVID or whatever. The weather is generating higher consumption and patterns that were maybe weren't anticipated. The meter system is subject to fluctuations due to these weather changes. Operating service events such as sewer backups, water main breaks are trending slightly lower than last year, which is great. This is also contributing to the projected surplus at this time of the year. Lastly, cost pressures are being experienced in utility costs. Overall, the operating surplus for water and sewer is anticipated to be $550,000 plus. So I think it's a good report at this time as an interim report as of June 30th. And I think we're on the right track with this thing.
Councillor Anthony?
Thank you, Your Worship. And you look good in that chair. So I wanted to touch base on, for me, what is the biggest part of this report is the surplus that we're looking at as of as of June of $550,000, which is a lot of money. It's not the highest amount, though, that we've ended up with in reserves. A couple of years back, I believe we had near $1 million. It was $900,000 and change. And of course, the reason I bring that up is I think most of you would know that I am often in favor of when I believe that our reserves are at a healthy level, because reserves are extremely important. If we have extra, trying to give it back, give the taxpayer a break, reduce the next year's levies, and so on. Especially with what people have gone through with unprecedented times, some people still not back to work, some people still not making the money they used to. Talked to a business owner today who said they'd love to be making 10% of what they used to make 3 or 4 months ago. And all that being said, the reason I bring that up is I was going to consider putting an amendment tonight, seeing if we could add a line that said, let's put this into the 2020 budget to give people a break. However, I see that we have another report coming on the 30th of September. I think it would be prudent to wait till then, see how it's looking at that point, see if it's the same, see if it's more, and then act at that point. But hopefully, I'm hopeful with the unprecedented times that we've seen, the continuing surpluses that we do see, which are not a bad thing. We need surpluses. But right now, the amounts we have, it says in the report, are bang on where they should be. They should be at 10% or whatever, 15% of your annual amounts in our two departments, the water and the sewer. Both are good. Both are in that range. That being said, I just wanted to note that for me, those surpluses are a real sticking point. I will support this. Obviously, we're just receiving and filing it. But that was something that I wanted to make you aware of this evening, because as budget chief, I know that's near and dear to your heart as well.
Any further discussion? I've got Councillor Mains and Councillor King and Councillor Mains.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Raybosch. So I support Councillor Anthony's concerns. I think it's early though, it's just June 30th. Let's wait until September, have a look at it and make it part of the budget considerations for 2021. But that we're going into it with another surplus, I think that has to help a little bit in considerations of taking some of the pressure off of sewer and water for 2021. But let's see where we are at the next budget update.
Councillor King.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just for council's benefit, I certainly support the direction that Councillor Anthony is talking about this at this point. And in doing some research and looking at the overall surpluses, both in the sewer and water, it's been substantial back to 2018. And, you know, in looking at the statements of the city, some $3.9 million was sitting in surplus, both in the sewer and water reserve funds, although unfortunately the balance wasn't correct. So the water surplus was very, very light, but the sewer side, the sewer surplus was substantial at $2.8 million. And I think when we start to go a little bit further, historically looking at these very, very large surpluses that we've been running, when we go back and we look at the balance December 31st, 2019, we had a surplus of $2.7 million in the sewer and water budget, and council did the right thing by balancing out both the water reserves and the sewer reserves so that they're properly balanced and the support is there. But I think it's high time that we now start to look at these excessive surpluses, and that we now move towards probably in September some sort of system that moves those surplus dollars back into the hands of the actual people that have paid these surpluses forward. So those are my comments, Deputy Mayor.
Okay. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll let Councillor Raybosch wrap it up.
Yeah, well, I agree with what you're saying, councillors. There, but I'm looking at 215 and 217, where you had in 215 you had a deficit of almost $600,000, and the other one you had $300,000. it's weather related. I agree with the idea that you give it back if you have too much in there, but I mean, the whole premise of the water thing was put in 2003 when the government decided not to fund any more sewers and water. It was told by 2008, your job was to create this system that took the amount of cost plus your contingency, divide by the number of users. So you have to be always prepared for not just the money we have like now, like I say, $600,000 loss in 2015, and then another one in there. So there are weather-related situations here and emergency things. So sometimes giving back a couple of dollars, as far as I'm concerned, will sometimes look good on paper, but when you have an emergency and you don't have the money, you have to go back to the taxpayer again. So I'm not sure sometimes whether, but I like the idea that we're going to look at it in budget time next year. Thank you.
All those in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Rabosh, seconded by Councillor King, that Council 1 receive the capital variance report as at July 21st, 2020, as set out in Report to Council Corp 2020-73, dated July 27th, 2020, from Blair Grant, and 2, authorize the reserve transfers and budget adjustments as detailed in Report to Council Corp 2020-73, dated July 27th, 2020, from Blair Grant, inclusive of Appendix A and B.
Any discussion? Councillor Rabosh?
Yeah, like this basically is just a standard mid-year update on completed capital projects. The cutoff period for this report was delayed in order to provide perspective after the budget transfers approved in July 21st meeting in Council. Council is providing authority to close completed projects as well as transfer unspent funds to corresponding 2020 ongoing capital projects. So we have to remember this is an interim report right at this point in time, just to kind of give us a slice of where we are with the projects that are out there.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Rabosh, seconded by Councillor King, that Council received the summary of open and active capital projects as at July 21st, 2020, as set out in Report to Council Corp 2020-74, dated July 27th, 2020, from Blair Grant for information purposes.
Any discussion? Councillor Rabosh?
This is another one of these interim reports. Council's regular update on the status of approved and open capital projects. So as with typical reports at this time of the year, there's a significant portion of unspent budget money because of the fact that a lot of these things don't start until July or August. So COVID did delay some of our capital projects initially as provincial requirements were clarified and it was determined that construction activity was safe to return to. If you notice, we had a couple of projects that COVID did not allow us to work on. As well, projects were delayed until an assessment of the projected financial impacts of the pandemic were reviewed. For clarity, unspent budget authority is not translated into an equal amount of excess cash. So I'm looking here at capital projects are financed by a combination of cash, debt, grants, and reserve funds. So what you're really looking at here is staff is working on a budget. They're doing best to keep us up to date on this stuff. And this is a good report as to show you where we are with the capital projects, which are open, which are there, and which really have to be worked on.
Any other discussion? Councillor Main?
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Rabosh. Really just two quick comments on two of the larger projects. Seymour Street and Castle Street, which have both been creating a lot of detour time and large work in the city. They're both considered on time and on budget at this time, substantially. Should be completed by the end of construction season with really just some finishing touches in the spring.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Rabosch, seconded by Councillor King, that Council receive and file the City of North Bay's year-end financial projection for the period ending June 30th, 2020, as set out in Report to Council Corp 2020-63, dated July 20, 2020, from Laura Boissonneau.
Any discussion? Councillor Rabosch?
Yeah, this again is, core services rely on the maintain things through the pandemic, including police, fire, transit, waste, and recycling. So what's happening here is this is an expectation of where we want to be. The city has been extremely mindful of costs and has made responsible decisions to ease the financial stress in the city and its residents by significantly offsetting revenue losses of more than $5 million. Revenue losses are expected to be partially offset with corporate-wide personnel cost savings of approximately $1.7 million. Other areas of cost savings include goods and services, agreement costs, service partner transfers. We expect the year end with a net deficit of 1.7, which, you know, everybody looks at this as a bad thing. I think you'll see further on that it's not so bad. That's far lower than many other communities. And even with a projected deficit, 2020 property tax revenues are not going to be affected. The city continues to make responsible financial decisions based on available information. This includes adjusting operations, mitigating costs, and doing whatever they can to cut the cost down. The city has stabilization reserves available to help cover the projected deficit. That's what these reserves are for. However, a replacement plan will be necessary as it took several years to build up these reserves. Reserves are critical to reducing the risk to the taxpayers of future uncontrollable operational events and activities. So the city continues to work with other levels of government on financial assistance and is expecting to receive funding for transit, especially it was already been announced, but we are working with the levels of government now to make sure that they understand we need some help. But I want to comment that as far as I'm concerned, the steps taken by the city to keep the city operating within this pandemic and to come out with this kind of a number shows a very good dedication of our staff and our people who work here and councillors who run the committees. So I think this is going to come out well for us in the end. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor May.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Rabosch. Really just on behalf of infrastructure and operations, reporting on two areas where there have been significant revenue shortfalls. Firstly, parking in the downtown areas. A lot of people due to COVID-19 have been able to work from home. Monthly lot rentals on street parking are down about $170,000. The biggest impact has really been on transit. Overall, that we weren't collecting revenues at all early in the spring as we tried to find a safe way for staff to operate the buses without touching money or getting near passengers. And with just less people riding the bus, the loss there right now is expected to be about $1.01 million. But the multi-billion dollar federal provincial COVID-19 relief package that was announced a few weeks ago, we're waiting for details on it, but we're optimistic that that will assist with a significant portion of that deficit. It would be wonderful, it would cover all of it, but we are expecting significant benefit from that.
I believe I saw Councillor King, yep.
Thank you, Your Worship, and Deputy Mayor, and I did, I did second the particular motion to receive that that report, and I think it's very interesting to suggest when we look at other communities around us that the deficit at this particular point only sits at $1.5 million. When we talk about reserves, and this has been a long discussion process, reserves are there to provide benefit when, in fact, we get into these very, very difficult situations. But by the same token, over the process, there's a constant need to provide money to keep those reserves in the particular position that they're in. We all listened from the finance department, you know, indicating the need to keep them between 5% and 10%. Once you deplete those reserves, obviously we've got to find money to replace those reserves. So that will, without question, have a net impact on the 2021 budget. I think the other things that we have to look at, and of course, Councillor Main indicated the shortfall in transit. We've been watching, the discussion that's been ongoing with the federal government. It appears that the funding issue really only meets the needs of what is transpiring with COVID. I don't see anything else in there that really suggests there's seed money for large ticket items that we all know are required here in the city. But having said that, I certainly have a number of concerns surrounding the operation. I know some councillors are privy to information that provides security from their benefit. But when I look at the process that we're going through, and I certainly look at the arenas, I know I didn't hear from the chair of community services with respect to that. Do we know at this particular point what minor hockey is looking at? What are those particular enrollment numbers? Are there going to be as many kids playing hockey in September? And I can tell you that is not going to be the case. And I guess the recent announcement that the OHL made with respect to the opening of their season, December 1st, certainly sent chills down my back with respect to the operation of Memorial Gardens. So the question at this point really, I think we all have to take a hard look at what this is going to look like in September. And there's no question as we look at COVID outbreaks taking place in the states, they've gone back, kids have gone back to school, and obviously there's been an outbreak. There's no question that the general public are watching this, especially parents with kids trying to decide whether or not they'll even send kids to school, certainly questions the delivery of certain opportunities that we provide as a city. So in saying that, I think it's imperative at this particular point that we start to take a real hard look at the finances. I think, council should take a real active role in listening to what staff have to say about what's transpired in the past. But I think we've got to understand where we're going at this point. And it just does not look good to me. I'm very, very concerned about the financial situation that we could find ourselves in. You know, I heard Councillor Raybosch talk about what can, staff are saying, and there's only some available information, and there are an awful lot of question marks out there about revenue generation and whether or not these facilities that are sitting vacant and have sat vacant since March will actually be used in September. So those are major concerns. And having said that, Deputy Mayor, I did want to give a notice of motion asking for staff to come back to council.
Are you going to be giving the notice of motion, sir?
I'll give it to you now.
Okay, no, you have to do it at the end. Sorry, just procedurally.
Okay. Well, I wasn't sure whether you got my note or not. So certainly if you give me that opportunity, I will speak to the notice of motion. But getting back to the issues, I mean, we are in a position here that no other council has ever been in the city of North Bay. And you got to really think about that. I've thought long and hard about the situation and how we actually manipulate or maneuver ourselves through the financial pitfalls that are sitting there. So I'll leave it at that. And if you would come back to me at the end of the meeting, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Next, I had Councillor Bain.
Thank you, Your Worship. It's interesting. I've been talking to staff through this whole process. I don't know why all of council hasn't been talking to people inside City Hall to see what's happening, whether it's transit, whether it's the arenas, whether it's water and sewer. You know, I've been having those discussions. I would have assumed that all of council would have been interested in having and had those conversations. In my conversations, I know that both the unions and the non-union staff have been working very hard. And not that they're doing anything that's earth-shattering, because business has been doing it as well. Business has had to learn to adapt through this whole process. We, you know, back in January and February, we saw China, what was happening there. Then we saw it in Europe. And then for some reason, we weren't quite prepared, but we should have been for how it transpired. But our staff, both union and management, have done a great job. And in talking with them over the past 4.5 months, I have a pretty good appreciation of where the budgets are. And this is a report that we're going to see another one like this in 3 months. At the end of September, the 30th of September, as of then, we'll see a report about a month later that is the next we see this every year. This isn't going to be a special report. Every year, council at this time sees a report, a financial a picture of where we're at the end of June, end of September, and then at the end of the year. So to say that we should be talking to, we now need to start talking to staff, I don't understand that. Also too, is that, you know, Melinda Fry is talking to the sports people, whether they're using the arenas, that she's reached out, done a survey with them. She's talking to the ball people and ball hockey people and the figure skating people and all of the user groups in sports to see what their plans are. But no telling what the plans are, what they have today. No, there's no guarantee that they're going to be the same rules are going to apply in 2 weeks. We just don't know. So it's the best estimate of what they've got. So I think everyone's done a great job in a very bad situation. And yes, the federal and the provincial government are going to be coming along with some funding. I'm optimistic that it's a per capita amount and that we'll be able to address any deficits that we have, especially in transit, as it's the biggest ticket item. And then hopefully that there may be revenue that we can put towards capital projects to put people back to work. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Council, did you already talk, Councillor Mayne?
Okay, I'm sorry,
Councillor
Mayne.
No, I was going to say, I remember if Councillor Mayne had spoken or not. I'm going to go to Councillor Mendocino.
Thanks, Your Worship. So again, great comments. I mean, what we're looking at is year-end projections, and you know, these year-end projections are based on you know, all information that the staff have to date. One thing we've learned about COVID is it's ever changing, but certainly these projections are as accurate as we can get to date. And I gotta tell you, I'm very happy with what with the numbers that I'm seeing, quite frankly. If you look at Sudbury is projecting, last we heard, a deficit of $10 million. They're three times our size. So if you look, if you want to compare apples and apples, that translates into about $3.5 million deficit for the city of North Bay. We are at $1.7 million. You know, the numbers are need to be highlighted. $5.3 million in lost revenue during COVID, $5.3 million. We've got it down to 1.7. In other words, staff, and with the leadership of our CAO, David Euler, and Margaret Karpenko, have found $3.6 million in inefficiencies, whether that be gapping, layoffs, whatever it is, $3.6 million in efficiencies to get us to $1.7 million. And I know that as the year goes on, they are continuing to look for efficiencies to reduce that $1.7 million. It's also important to note that out of that $1.7 million for the city as a whole, $1 million of that is through transit. And that was, council made a conscious decision, as they should have at the time, to keep transit going on a limited basis the way we did, because we were hearing loud and clear that there was a need in the community for that. So you take away transit, all of a sudden you're at 700,000. We talked about reserves earlier. This is exactly what reserves are for. You can't have picked a more pandemic emergency to have reserves available for. This council is gonna deal with the $1.7 million deficit. Hopefully it's lower, but we will deal with that deficit through existing reserves and through the 2020 capital budget. We will not be going back to the taxpayer for any more money in 2020. We are gonna handle this within the 2020 budget. And if you would have asked any of us, and I've asked some citizens this, if I had asked you before this pandemic that we could handle the financial negative impact of 5.2 within our existing 2020 budget, would you have been happy? And the answers I get, yes, absolutely. So kudos to staff, for doing a great job. Kudos, to council. I mean, this has been everybody pulling together. The numbers are there. We have a strong balance sheet. We always appreciate funding from other levels of government, but we have a strong balance sheet and we are very well positioned financially coming out of COVID. Full stop. Thank you.
So Councillor Mayne, you did speak earlier, but perhaps there might be an opportunity at a later motion where you might be able to sneak what you're looking for. So next I have Councillor Brusseau.
Councillor Mendocino echoed a lot of my saying, but one thing to be assured with the community service staff, they are very prudent, and for our recreational facilities, they do send out a survey and they will not open a facility unless they know they can operate it at a high capacity. Right now, Memorial Gardens has 95% ice rental. So we will not open another rink until we have a high number of committed people wanting to rent the ice, and then we will open. So it is very prudent, and that is why, like Councillor Mendocino said, our deficit is very low, and we will continue to do that. I am also in communication with staff. I would say every second day, I am talking to staff and staying on top of it. So thank you.
Is there any other discussion before Councillor Raybosch wraps it up? Seeing none, Councillor Raybosch.
I just want to echo some of the things that Councillor Mendocino and Councillor Brusseau, the department heads, the committee heads, have really been working hard to keep their budgets within line. Our staff, they've made efficiencies, they've worked really hard. And I think out of this meeting tonight and out of this report, I appreciate the fact that Councillor King wants a little more of an update. But this should be a reassuring fact to the public that this council and the staff worked very hard so that it would be no taxpayer effect in 2020, even though the pandemic is here. We've managed it, we are going to manage it, and I think everybody needs a congratulations on this thing.
Okay. All in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Moved by Councillor Brusseau, seconded by Councillor Robertson, that Council authorize planning staff to issue a statement of concurrence to Spectrum Telecom Group Limited, Spectrum Group, for the construction of a proposed 12.2 meter antenna mast installation to be installed at 222 McIntyre Street West.
Councillor Brusseau?
A tripod antenna is being replaced by a 12.2 meter antenna mast that will be installed on 222 McIntyre West. The new antenna will increase the strength of the system.
Any further discussion? Councillor Raybosch?
This probably leads into something that really affects what I think happens here. Anytime we get an increase and help get our telecommunications brought up more up to date, to me, that's a draw. If we're going to draw new people here and bring businesses here, we have to have the connectivity. So one of the big pushes we need is for there. I congratulate them. And anytime you can get new towers, new efficiencies in there, great for the community, because it's going to draw people here for us.
Any more discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Motion's carried.
Moved by Councillor Main, seconded by Councillor Anthony, that Council approve the award of a contract to Via Mobility LLC, a wholly owned subsidiary of Via Transportation Inc., in the amount of $71,645 plus HST for a dynamic dispatch for transit services pilot, with an option to extend the contract for 3 years, for three additional years, if the pilot is successful.
Any discussion? Councillor Main and then Councillor Anthony.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Vrabosh, and hopefully allow me a little bit of latitude, but this is something we've been working to for a significant amount of time. This is a major step, contracting the software provider to help us manage off-peak hour service. In spite of $1 million deficit this year in transit, we're still trying to help people get back from work late in the evening. In many cases, it's not practical to run a full bus route to bring someone back from one stop. So we're looking forward to implementing this program that's been successful in other communities like Belleville. But it's a result of speaking with staff on a regular, ongoing basis, trying to find cost savings within our budget. We've been working on this since COVID began. Staff have been very helpful, very supportive. I think we all have the cell phone numbers of all the senior directors we speak to on close to a daily basis, and they've been very helpful in trying to help find costs that if we can't cancel, like there's work that needs to be done in the city, but in some cases, some things can at least be deferred to postpone our expenditures. So we're working on that as well. Ultimately, it'll be a decision at the final budget in the fall. But I think staff have been very supportive in trying to help us manage through our costs at this specific time.
I have Councillor Anthony.
So on the particular motion in front of us, which is about what I have referred to in the past many times as transit on demand, and John Severino at City Hall corrects me and lets me know that it's dynamic dispatch is the proper term. And so I'm going to try and remember to say that from here on, dynamic dispatch. I am super excited about this. This has been something that we've been talking about for well over a year. I do recall that it was you, Deputy Mayor Vrabosh, who first showed me another city that was doing it. I thought it was really great. When I was chairing what was engineering and works, that was one of the things that, as transit came over, I really, really was excited about and wanted to get implemented. And of course, staff started to work on. And as we know, RFPs, requests for proposals and requests for things like that take a while. So it took a while to get it all together. It took a while to get it out. But now we've had the companies that know what they're doing respond, and we have one selected. For those who don't remember in the public, the reason that this is really something interesting is when you look at the transit system, it's a very, very costly beast. It's a very costly thing for the city, but it's also a very, very important thing for the city. And when you look at the fact that in off-peak times, because this is the certain route, let's just use a street like Jane or Bloom or whatever, that's the route, a bus is going to go through there once or twice an hour, whatever the rate is for that route, all evening until it stops, even if only one or two or three people use it. And we sometimes know this after, you know, seeing enough stats that that's pretty much all that happens. Now we would be able to have some extra vehicles. People can either call and book in advance online, which of course means the phone in the palm of their hand as well, which is super convenient, and request, I would need a ride at this time. We would avoid having those buses looping around sort of what we would call the empty routes after certain hours, and instead just make a meaningful trip to pick people up. These certain buses would adapt and go to different places, kind of like when you think about it, I guess kind of like a taxi, right? They adapt and they go where they need to. And really, I see that as a win really not just a win-win, but a win-win-win when I think about it, because the environment wins. You don't have a bus running empty, you know, through these certain routes. The taxpayer wins because they're not paying to carry the cost of that bus running through those routes and the wear and tear on the vehicles, which we have to maintain and replace eventually. And then ultimately the citizens and the users. So imagine if I would hope, and this is just a hope because I know we're just looking at the pilot, when we have places like Highway 11 North that have businesses up there, but don't have real transit service. And I know good employers up there who, to keep good employees who can't quite afford a car yet, they drive down the hill and pick them up. They pick them up or drop them off after work. That's pretty impressive. Anyway, that being said, since it's not needed twice an hour, every hour, 17 hours a day or 12 hours a day, maybe we could use it for the 4 hours a day that it is. So I'm really excited to see how this plays out. And the other one thing I wonder, and maybe staff will be able to let me know after the meeting, I'll touch base with Mr. Severino, is if some of that MAT, the tourism accommodation dollars that we got, could go towards this. Because to me, this could also be something that could help tourism. When people could literally say, a family staying at such and such a hotel, they want to get to see the waterfront, whatever it is they want to see, could they use it as well? Could it be related to tourism? Could that possibly help pay for this? Anyway, thank you for the leeway.
Councillor Robertson, then Councillor King.
Thanks a lot, Deputy Mayor Raybosch. I was getting right ready to have a debate with Councillor Main about who about this particular initiative, but he didn't go there, so I'll yield on that one. I'll stand down. This is something I'm really excited about. Somebody who uses transit a lot. I haven't used it since COVID-19, but hopefully this, like we said, this is a pilot project. So I'm not exactly sure exactly how it's going to work on the user side, and we'll have to see how the consumer reacts to this new product and the new service. But I'm very interested to see how it works, very interested to see how people react to this. I will definitely be trying it, and I'll be providing a review to the public and to anybody else who will listen. Councillor Anthony highlighted a lot of the fact that it's going to provide efficiencies, which is great. For me, the main focus is, as Councillor Anthony also said, is that this is going to be a service upgrade for the users, I think. I think this, I've heard stories from people in other cities, secondhand, about how this type of service has worked in other places. So somebody who gets off work at 8 p.m. in off-peak hours would sometimes have to wait until 9 p.m. to take the next bus in order to get home. Hopefully, with this situation, that person, the service for that person is going to be much more convenient, and it will encourage people to use the service. And that's what this is all about, is increasing users. And if you increase users for transit, to me, that's a climate initiative, and that's an anti-poverty initiative. So a really good chance to be a win here. Hopefully the efficiencies, should we realize efficiencies, I'd really like to see those efficiencies put back into the service so that during peak hours, if we're not using our drivers as much, or if we're not using our buses as much in off-peak hours, hopefully we'd be able to have an increased service level during peak hours for the regular service. But that's a conversation to be had once we see what happens with this pilot project. Super, super excited to see it, and I can't wait to try it. Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor.
Thank you. And now I have Councillor King.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. I'm certainly prepared to support it, but I did want to relay information I just received directly ahead of this council meeting. The City of Belleville actually has discontinued the service. And I would suggest that it may be staff's job to talk to transit people in Belleville to determine whether or not what the reasoning was for the discontinuation of the service, to make sure that we don't have a pitfall that we fall into in this process.
Any further? Oh, Councillor Mendocino.
Thanks, Your Worship. So very excited to approve this. A lot of great comments so far. I mean, we will see improved customer service, and it's going to create operational efficiencies. So great that it's going to be a pilot project. I think we're ahead of the curve here. I do think this is transit the way transit is somewhat going to be delivered in the future. And, you know, it came to mind as I was reading the report with the $1 million deficit that we had during COVID with our existing system. I just wondered if this down the line, if this system had been fully implemented, if that impact of $1 million would have been lessened with something like this. So I share my colleagues' optimism and excitement. Let's see what this is going to look like and move forward from there. Thank you.
Any further comments? Okay, all in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Raybosch, seconded by Councillor Tiganelli. Whereas the Government of Canada and the Province of Ontario have announced $4 billion in funding for municipal government and transit relief. And whereas the City of North Bay is thankful to the provincial and federal governments for understanding the fiscal challenges municipal governments are facing. And whereas during the pandemic, the City of North Bay has made tough decisions in its response to providing safe public services during a pandemic in a fiscally responsive manner. And whereas an allocation-based formula model is already established through the federal government tax model. And whereas the duration and severity of the COVID-19 crisis remains unknown, and whereas sustainability is vital to ensuring that municipalities can manage financially in 2020 and not at the expense of financially crippling 2021, and whereas providing flexible policy options allows municipal leaders to use funds and resources where it is needed most in their community. And whereas municipalities are critical partners in the economic recovery process, therefore be it resolved that the following recommendations be made to the provincial and federal governments with respect to the non-transit relief funding. One, that the allocation model for the relief funding be established on a per capita basis, leveraging the existing administrative infrastructure of the federal gas tax system. Number two, that the funding be unrestricted, allowing each municipality the flexibility to deal with their unique community challenges related to the impacts of COVID-19. Number three, that any funds a community may receive above their 2020 deficit shall be designated to offset ongoing COVID-19 related deficits and related budget pressures in 2021. Number four, that any further unused funds are eligible to be transferred to capital and used in the same manner as the Federal Gas Tax Fund program as part of Canada's COVID-19 economic recovery plans. And further, that a copy of this resolution be forwarded to Premier Doug Ford, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, provincial and federal ministers associated with the funding, MP Anthony Rota, MPP Vic Fideli, Federation of Northern Ontario Municipalities, Association of Municipalities Ontario, Rural Ontario Municipal Association, Francophone Association of Municipalities of Ontario, Ontario Good Roads Association, Northwestern Ontario Municipal Association, and the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
And I'll go to Councillor Raybosch as the mover.
Yeah, I guess the motion that I'm glad to put on the floor tonight was really something that was brought on by my appointment to FNOM, because I talked to a lot of municipal leaders in this thing, and there are phone calls going around by government people suggesting, you know, how is COVID affecting your community, which leads me to believe there could be a possibility of playing one community against another. We already have a situation where the premier has asked the federal government unencumbered money. So we also have an implied line right now with the gas tax, an actual system that works on a where we need to get into this and make sure that we're not being penalized for something because we've done it well. So I think we just need to ask for the same flexibility from the provincial government that they asked for from the federal government. We know what's needed for the same thing. And I think this motion is that important that the government has to know. We don't want you playing one community against another one. If one did poorly, they don't deserve any more than the rest of who worked hard at getting yours in line. We want it on a person balance, same as the federal gas tax. but we want unencumbered money according to our population. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Tignelli, did you want to speak to it as a seconder? You're okay. Any other, anybody else would like to speak to it? Seeing none, all in favor? Those opposed? Motion is carried. So just before we end the meeting tonight, and I know that I'd received a message from Councillor Anthony, we wanted to make sure that we did this prior to going in camera. So this is the time where people tend to leave the meeting or sign off from watching. But we've recently lost a previous council member. Councillor Maureen Bolt had served with the City of North Bay and passed earlier this week. So we want to make sure that, last week, and we want to make sure that we take a moment of silence for her. But before we do that, I wanted to open it up to anybody if they had anything to say. I know that Councillor Anthony, as being the longest serving member on council and has served with Maureen, I know that he definitely wanted to say something, but I will open it up if anybody would like to say anything. So I'll start off with Councillor Anthony.
Thanks, Your Worship. When I got on council in the year 2000, she was, I believe, in her second term, Maureen was. And by no means would I say she and I were best pals, but we certainly had a few laughs, and we could certainly debate the issues and then talk about other things when we saw each other elsewhere. What I can say is that, my goodness, she was fearless. She was a force to be reckoned with, and she certainly always fought for what she believed in. And she did that with passion at the council table. And I think a lot of people will have fond memories of the people that either she helped or the causes that she helped or some of the things she fought for. I think there'll be folks who will remember her for that. And I appreciate that you would take this time tonight for that.
Thank you. Councillor King?
Thanks, Deputy Mayor. And certainly it was a real shock to hear that Maureen had passed. And I've known Maureen for a great number of years. On a personal basis, not on a business basis. Well aware of her son, Jordan, and of course, the life experiences I think that Maureen had over a fair length of time. She was obviously very, very involved in the community. And I think George Maroos has certainly said it best in an article, I think it was in Bay Today, either yesterday or today, suggesting that she fought for the little guy. That's something I think that many of us can certainly relate with. We try to do the best for our community, and Maureen tried to do the best. I think she succeeded in doing it. And it's a real shame to see somebody pass away at such a young age. Thank you.
Anybody else? So just end it there, just to say that, from hearing from people on council that, she was feisty, but she really did have a love for life. And if you saw her in the community, whether she was dancing up a storm, one of the local establishments, or out with her family, and she really did have a love for life and a real passion for this community. So we'll at this point take a moment of silence for her. Thank you, everyone. Before Ms. Keech reads the, before we convene for in camera, I just want to let Councillor King know that the notice of motion happens when we reconvene after we come back out of in camera. So I just didn't want you to think I forgot about you.
Okay, that's fair. Thank you.
Ms. Keech?
Moved by Councillor Bill Raybosch, seconded by Councillor King, that Council adjourn in camera pursuant to subsection 239(2) of the Municipal Act 2001, as amended, at 7:35 p.m. for the following reasons. Item number 11 being labor relations, and item number 12 being a proposed disposition of lands by the municipality.
Okay, and this concludes the regular portion of the meeting. We will adjourn in camera and return after the closed session. Okay. So,
Moved by Councillor Bill Brabosch, seconded by Councillor King, that Council reconvene at 8:52 p.m.
All in favor? Those opposed? Carried. Okay, now Councillor King, this is your portion for notice of motion. Please make sure that you just advise us of the intention of the motion, and then you would leave the details to the motion itself when it comes to Council.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor, and certainly, yes, I did want to give notice of motion, very simply. The motion would request staff at a later Council meeting, actually in a committee meeting, to provide a financial update once the third quarter of the budget is completed for the year 2020.
Okay, and thank you very much.
Moved by Councillor Bill Brabosch, seconded by Councillor King, that the following bylaw be read a first and second time. Bylaw number 2020-63 to confirm proceedings of the regular meeting of Council held on August the 11th, 2020.
Any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councillor Bill Brabosch, seconded by Councillor King, that the following bylaw be read a third time and passed. Bylaw number 2020-63.
Any discussion? All in favor? Those opposed? Carried.
Moved by Councillor Mendocino, seconded by Councillor Bain, that this regular meeting of Council do now adjourn at 8:53 p.m.
I'm assuming there's no discussion, so all in favor? Those opposed? Carried. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.